the Trump administration has an emerging deal with the Taliban, and it has the potential to bring greater stability to Afghanistan after an 18-year inconclusive war in that country. Or it could reignite the Afghan civil war, emboldening terrorist groups and plunging the nation into another decade of turmoil, which might then force the United States to return to the battlefield in large numbers. That is, after all, what happened after the U.S. withdrew too quickly from Iraq in 2011. It all depends on how it is handled from now. The key must be a political settlement between the Taliban and the Afghan government, and not the rapid withdrawal of U.S. troops. President Trump deserves some credit for having authorized the negotiations in Doha between a special envoy, Zalmay Khalilzad, and the Taliban. The next step is to broaden the talks to involve the Afghan government itself. The end result would be a national unity government that includes both the current Afghan government and the Taliban. But the crucial issue for Washington is to ensure that it does not make concessions that are hard to reverse, such as drawing down American troops, while the Taliban, for its part, makes paper commitments that it can easily violate. The former ambassador to Afghanistan, Ryan Crocker, worries that we may be watching a replay of Vietnam, in which the U.S. got commitments from North Vietnam in return for its withdrawal. But once U.S. troops were withdrawn, North Vietnam reneged on its commitments and invaded South Vietnam. The most effective way to ensure this does not happen in Afghanistan is for Washington to delay the troop drawdowns until tangible gains have been made in terms of political power sharing and national reconciliation. It can push the Taliban to keep its promises by formally bringing neighboring powers such as China, Pakistan, and even Iran into the discussions. The United States has faced this exit strategy problem every time it has waged a war against a guerrilla force. Henry Kissinger described the dilemma memorably in a foreign affairs essay written prior to his appointment as National Security Advisor in 1969. While the U.S. pursues a military strategy, he wrote, the guerrillas have a psychological strategy, which is simply to exhaust America's willpower. Thus, America loses by not winning. But the guerrillas win just by not losing. The Taliban has gone one step further than a guerrilla operation, having established its own governance independent from the Afghan national government in some areas. But the group's core strategy does appear to be wait out the United States. If the deal between the Taliban and Washington is to hold, Trump must signal that he would send back the troops if the Taliban breaks its end of the deal. Trust but verify, Ronald Reagan said. That should be the mantra for these negotiations. Everyone will seek gains from the U.S. up front in return for promises to be fulfilled later. Washington should not be fooled. The United States has actually achieved a lot in Afghanistan. The country is in a decent place after 40 years of civil war and Taliban rule. Let me give you one example. Under the Taliban, there were only 1 million Afghan children in school. Today, there are more than 9 million. The terrorist organization that the Taliban harbored, Al-Qaeda, has been severely weakened. And the costs for America today, 14,000 troops, are not nearly what they once were. The U.S. could cut that number to 8,000 or 9,000 under the New Deal while still maintaining order in Afghanistan and fighting terrorism. But first, Washington needs to make sure it doesn't just end the war, but also wins the peace. For more, go to cnn.com/Fareed and read my Washington Post column. And let's get started. The U.S. and China are in a trade war that is rattling markets for certain. But let's not forget that Japan and South Korea are also in a trade tussle. And then there's the future mess that Brexit will inflict on global trade. If you add in the fact that it's been more than 10 years since the last recession ended, and make note of the wonky fact that the 2-year Treasury yield has topped the 10-year rate, you get to an understandable fear of recession. This is a serious matter, and we have a very serious panel to discuss it. Rana Faruha is CNN's global economic analyst. Edward Luce is the FT's U.S. national editor. Richard Haas is the president of the Council on Foreign Relations. Rana, you wrote a piece saying the global recession has actually already begun. Now, yes, that is still sort of a minority view. Tell me why you think it's happening.
Well, even before you had this inverted bond yield curve, which is a very wonky way of saying that people are very worried about the economy going forward, and that's a big predictor of recession, even before that, you had a lot of signs that all was not well. If you look over the last 18 months at manufacturing indexes, they are down in basically every major country except for India. In Europe in particular, in the Eurozone, down very sharply. Germany has gone into recession. China is slowing down. Also, the U.S. consumer, which, you know, we hear a lot about how buoyant the U.S. consumer has been, there's actually signs of fragility there, too. People are very worried about prescription drug price hikes. You're seeing actually some interesting voting patterns, working-class white women turning away from Trump because they're concerned about the slowing economy. You're seeing people scaling back on gasoline purchases in the middle of a summer travel season. So I've been looking kind of beyond the headline figures, and I think there's just a lot of weakness.
And do you think that the, shall we call it, policy uncertainty, because there really is, you know, Japan, South Korea, U.S., China, U.S., Europe, there's still the dangers of trade wars, that adds to it?
Hugely. I mean, look, with any previous downturn you can think of, there's been policy coordination across borders. The U.S. is, you know, in the 80s, there was a Plaza Accord. In 2008, there was a G20 meeting in London. In the mini-recession or fears of recession, 2015, 2016, again, international coordination. The prospect of any international coordination with Trump as president is extremely low. And so the policy uncertainty really comes from the White House. America is not playing the role and is very unlikely to play the role to help sort of coordinate an international response to a global downturn that it's been playing for 70 years. That's a huge factor here.
And Trump is, you know, seems to be almost worried about the politics more than the policy, where he's trying to position it as if this is all the Federal Reserve's fault, right?
He is at war with his own chairman of the Federal Reserve. And just as an aside, you know, interest rates are already historically low. There's not a lot of stimulus, shall we say, still to be played out. Fiscal stimulus is already great, given what we've done. So we're late in the cycle, as anyone who follows
markets. Just to explain what you mean by all that is, interest rates are low, they can't be cut too much further. We've already done a big tax cut, so the budget deficit is high. You can't do more government spending. So we're out of ammunition.
Pretty much. We're close to being out of it. You've got all the geopolitics, which are another overlay, plus one other thing, Donald Trump's trade war. He's at war with himself in an odd sort of way, that his biggest talking point has been the stimulus he's given to the American economy. And what he's doing on Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays is essentially offsetting that with tariffs, be it against China or everybody else. And right, he's now become, in some ways, the greatest overhang over his own biggest accomplishment.
The Chinese have tried to calm the waters. This is a very rare thing to see.
Yeah.
It's not the U.S. The U.S. is roiling the waters, and the Chinese are saying, no, no, don't worry, guys. We'll probably come. We'll meet them halfway.
Well, the Chinese have always said, look, we're willing to come to the table, but they've also made it very clear that they want any trade deal to be a deal between equals. Unfortunately, President Trump seems constitutionally incapable of creating a win-win situation. In order to win, for him to feel he's won, he needs to crush the other side. The Chinese have drawn a line in the sand, and when they do that, they don't back away, and there's not a lot of interplay. I think the other thing that the markets are worried about is the fact that this most recent Fed rate cut really just didn't juice things. And I agree with Richard that we're at the end of a long period of easy money, and I think that all this psychology is now coming to the fore, and you're going to see fits and starts, but I think the next few months are going to be a downward cycle.
Freak, I said at one point, you know, with China, it's almost like North Korea. We're asking for things they cannot give.
Right,
we're telling
exactly.
North Korea, you got to give up your nuclear weapons. They're not going to do it. Iran, regime change, they're not going to do it. China is not going to take the state out of the economy.
Yeah.
They're not going to become capitalist tomorrow. It's going to remain a guided economy. So we're asking for things that mean either we fall off our own demands or there cannot be a trade deal.